Hello, everyone, and welcome. My name is Taryn A. Comito, and I'm the Director of Education and Outreach for Nevada Ballet Theater, and I'm so happy that all of you can be here for Dracula. You're in for a very special treat this day, today. It's not night anymore. Today, I have a special guest here, Mr. Marcus Bugler. He is an academy instructor with our faculty, and he is also playing the role of the priest in Dracula. Enjoy.
Greetings and good day, everyone. Thank you all very much for coming. This is a real treat for Nevada Ballet Theater to be able to do a ballet like this, especially around Halloween and kind of get all creepied out. It's wonderful. I wanted to borrow, there's a lady in the back who has this wonderful little bat tiara. I was actually threatening to borrow it. All righty, well, good afternoon and welcome to Nevada Ballet Theater and our Insights program, which offers you, our audience, an opportunity to discover the background to today's performance of Dracula. The story of Dracula is famous across the world and established many conventions of vampire fantasy. How many of you have heard of Dracula? How many of you have seen a movie or a stage production of Dracula? No brainer. Scary? Scary. Some of it scary, right? Some scary, some... Well, today you will see this dramatic story told through the beautiful medium of dance. The original story was written by Bram Stoker, a British author who between 1879 and 1898 was a business manager for the Lyceum Theatre in the West End of London. Stoker supplemented his income by writing a large number of sensational novels, his most successful being the vampire tale Dracula, published on the 26th of May in 1897. Parts of it are set around the town of Whitby in the north of England, where Stoker spent his summer holidays. At that time, the so-called invasion literature was at a peak, and Stoker's formula was very familiar by 1897 to readers of fantastic adventure stories of an invasion of England by continental European influence. Throughout the 1880s and 1890s, other famous authors such as Rudyard Kipling, Robert Louis Stevenson, Arthur Conan Doyle, and H.G. Wells wrote many tales in which fantastic creatures threatened the British Empire. Before writing Dracula, Stoker spent 7 years researching European folklore and stories of vampires, being most influenced by Emily Gerard's 1885 essay, Transylvania Superstitions, which includes content about a vampire myth. Some historians are convinced that a historic figure, Vlad III Dracula, often called Vlad the Impaler, was the model for Stoker's Count, although there is no supporting evidence. Stoker borrowed only scraps of miscellaneous information, according to one expert, about this bloodthirsty tyrant of Wallachia, and there are no comments about him in Stoker's working notes. Dracula scholar Elizabeth Miller has remarked that aside from the name and some mention of Romanian history, the background of Stoker's Count bears no resemblance to Vlad III Dracula. Stoker also claimed that he had a nightmare about a vampire king rising from his grave, caused probably by eating too much crab the night before. The Dead Undead was one of Stoker's original titles for Dracula, and the manuscript was simply entitled The Undead. Up until a few weeks before publication, Stoker's notes for Dracula show that the name of the Count was originally Count Vampire. Hello, I'm Count Vampire. Here you can see Stoker's handwritten notes about the characters, and if you look carefully, halfway down, you can see Vampire's name has been crossed out and replaced with Dracula. I'm Dracula. That's so much better. Stoker became intrigued by the name Dracula while doing research after reading William Wilkinson's book. Here's a title for you. An account of the principalities of Wallachia and Moldavia with political observations relative to them, which he found in the Whitby Library and consulted a number of times during visits to Whitby in the 1890s. The name Dracula was the patronym Draculia of the descendants of Vlad II of Wallachia, who took the name Dracul after being invested in the Order of the Dragon in 1431. In the old Romanian language, the word Dracul, Romanian drac, dragon, and ul, the, meant the dragon. And Dracula meant son of the dragon. In the present day, however, Dracul means the devil. Although now a widely known vampire novel, Dracula was not the first. Johann Wolfgang von Goethe published The Bride of Corinth in 1797. From my grave to wander, I am forced still to seek the god's long-severed link, still to love the bridegroom I have lost, and the lifeblood of his heart to drink. It's pretty cool. Later, Sheridan Le Fanu's 1871 Carmilla, about a lesbian vampire, could have inspired Bram Stoker's Dracula, or Varney the Vampire, a lengthy penny dreadful serial from the mid-Victorian period by James Malcolm Rymer. John Polidori created the image of a vampire portrayed as an aristocratic man. Like the character of Dracula in his tale, The Vampire, 1819. He wrote Vampire during a summer which he spent with Frankenstein creator Mary Shelley, her husband, poet Percy Bysshe Shelley, and Lord Byron in 1816. Dracula was published in London in May of 1897 by Archibald Constable and Company, costing 6 shillings. The novel was bound yellow cloth and titled in red letters, as you can see on the left above. The yellow cover was used in those days to warn readers of books that had pornographic content. On the left, or actually on the right, you can see the first edition in America, published in 1899 by Doubleday and McClure of New York. Dracula was not an immediate bestseller when it was first published, although reviewers were unstinting in their praise. The Contemporary Daily Mail ranked Stoker's powers above those of Mary Shelley and Edgar Allan Poe, as well as Emily Bronte's Wuthering Heights. The book did not make much money for Stoker. In the last year of his life, he was so poor that he had to petition for a compassionate grant from the Royal Literary Fund, and his widow was forced to sell his notes and outlines of the novel at a Sotheby's auction in 1913, where they were purchased for a little over £2, about $3. The story of Dracula has been the basis for 217 films and countless plays. Stoker himself wrote the first theatrical adaptation, which was presented at the Lyceum Theater on the 18th of May, 1897, under the title Dracula or the Undead. Shortly before the novel's publication, it performed only once in order to establish his own copyright for such adaptations. The adaptation was first published only a century later in October of 1997. The first motion picture to feature Dracula was Dracula's Death, produced in Hungary, 1921. The now lost film, however, was not an adaptation of Stoker's novel, but featured an original story. The first film version to really popularize the story of Dracula was made in 1931. It features Bela Lugosi as Dracula, Edward Van Sloan as Abraham Van Helsing, roles that they had just premiered on stage in New York. Here's the opening of the film, even though it's from the early days of filmmaking, still pretty scary.
I am Dracula. Listen to them, children of the night. What music they make.
I am Dracula. You know, it doesn't get better than that. I do raise a question, though, about armadillos in Transylvania. They probably brought them out because they were a little scarier than the bats. In 1958, British film company Hammer Film Productions followed the success of its Curse of Frankenstein the previous year with Dracula. Released in the U.S. as Horror of Dracula, directed by Terence Fisher. Fisher's production featured Christopher Lee as Dracula and Peter Cushing as Van Helsing. It was an international hit for Hammer Film, and Lee fixed the image of the fanged vampire in popular culture, reprising the role many times in other films over the next decade and a half. Here is a clip of Christopher Lee in his first performance as Dracula in the famous film. All right. A word about Ben Stevenson. Ben Stevenson is the choreographer for this particular production that you're going to see today. The ballet version of Dracula we're about to see today was choreographed by Ben Stevenson, OBE, which stands for Order of the British Empire. It premiered on March 13th of 1997, 100 years since the original story was written. It was a co-production between Houston Ballet, where Mr. Stevenson was then director, and Pittsburgh Ballet Theater. Stevenson is from England and danced with both the Sadler's Wells Royal Ballet and London Festival Ballet. He transformed Houston Ballet from a regional dance troupe into one of the country's leading ballet companies. He is famous for his detailed stagings of the classics, as well as his ability to bring stories such as Dracula alive. In his scenario for the ballet version of Dracula, Ben Stevenson distilled the essence of Bram Stoker's novel, retaining key characters and dramatic situations. He amended elements of the novel to make it possible to tell the story in the language of ballet and make the work more theatrically compelling. In Stevenson's version, the ballet takes place entirely in Transylvania without armadillos, with the first and third acts taking place in Dracula's castle and the second act in the village. His synopsis is as follows. Act one, the crypt of Dracula's castle. In the evening, Count Dracula and his wives awaken from their coffins in the crypt of his castle. In order to satisfy the lust of the Count, Renfield, Dracula's trusted henchman, arrives in a coach with Flora, a lovely young girl from the village. Act two, the village. The innkeeper and his wife are celebrating the 18th birthday of their daughter Svetlana with the villagers. Frederick, a young man from the village in love with her, asks the innkeeper for her hand in marriage. At the height of the festivities, Count Dracula, who has been informed of the beauty of Svetlana, arrives to abduct her. Act three, the bedroom of Count Dracula. Flora and the other brides await the return of Count Dracula. He enters with Svetlana, who is to become his next bride. At the climax of her initiation, Frederick, accompanied by the priest and the innkeeper, storms into the Count's bedroom in an attempt to save her. Ben Stevenson asked one of the greatest arrangers of music for ballet, John Lanchberry, to find and arrange the music for Dracula. Lanchberry says, "Ben and I were attempting to create an atmosphere of mid-19th century terror overtaking a Romanian village. So I chose the music of Franz Liszt, as his music flourished during the Gothic period in literature. Exactly the time period of Dracula. I remember Ben saying to me, try to find something for Dracula to change into a bat and fly around the stage." One of Liszt's pieces that is used in the ballet is the famous Mephisto Waltz, which incidentally Sir Kenneth MacMillan also used for his ballet Meyerling. Here's the very beginning of the first waltz played on piano.
Thank you.
always wish I'd learned how to play piano so you could do that thing. The amazing sets were designed by Thomas Boyd and the gorgeous costumes by Giudana Lynn. Lynn said of her costumes, "I researched the German romantics of the late 19th century, as well as visited the Metropolitan Museum Costume Institute to look at costume design of Romania. I like to look at the real thing and then abstract and modify those ideas through my particular imagination for dancers to dance in. Usually normal people don't have to do pirouettes and arabesques so that we have to make accommodations for doing unusual movements." The role of Count Dracula is an exhausting one for the male dancer. He has to maneuver with a very large cape, probably about 15-ish pounds, easy, that he also has to dance in. Ben Stevenson, the choreographer, is now director of Texas Ballet Theater, and one of their principal dancers, Carl Coomer, is in the clip following describing the challenges of the role.
My name's Carl Coomer. I'm a principal dancer at Texas Ballet Theater, which I joined in 2007. I've been here for about 7 years now. Dracula's different because you're playing an evil villain, if you like, and usually, especially for male dancers, we get to play princes a lot and, you know, be this elegant prince a lot of the time. So to actually be this dark, mean, like, villain of a character, it's a lot of fun. It's always fun to be evil. The hardest part of performing Dracula is doing Act One of Dracula, because you don't really leave the stage very often. And there's a partitoire, there's a partitoire, there's solos, and then as it builds to a climax at the end of Act One, and you're pretty exhausted, then it gets really hard. So by the end of it, you just kind of collapse on the floor, and after you've given yourself, you know, to the whole role.
Isn't that wonderful? Just as a footnote, I had an opportunity to work with the gentleman who choreographed this ballet back in 1970, 71. He was in charge of a group of young dancers, Harkness Youth Dancers in New York City, and subsequently became the director of the Harkness Ballet, took us on a huge tour of Europe, and we got to meet choreographer John Cranko, Yuri Killian, just opportunity after opportunity. It was a wonderful time. But after having, he was here just last weekend working with the dancers, and giving his input into their work, our work, and he's just, you know, he's a formidable force of nature, just amazing, very funny, very personable. You know, just great to see him after many, many years of not having seen him. And his work that I partook of in that particular time period was a kind of the basis of things that I've seen of his, works that I've seen of his. So I'm going to open up just maybe one or two questions, ladies and gentlemen. I want to thank you all primarily for being here. I know we've got to get you into the theater fairly soon, but if you have any questions, please bring them forward. Just one thing if you want to know, Pittsburgh Ballet Theater did in fact loan us costumes, sets, scenery, all of that. So that's where that is going to be from, that when you see that. Well, ladies and gentlemen, if you don't have any more questions, I invite you to hop on into the theater. Thank you so much for being here, being such a great audience. I appreciate it. Have a great time.